And welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect 3. Blind, I am the RPG chick, as always. We're starting the Leviathan DLC. Now, some of you may be wondering, I stated that I was going to try again to reinstall the 4K textures a second time. When I tried it, well, before I started playing the game just wouldn't run at all, so kind of messed up. So I'm going to try again. It took me like 2 days to do it. So it's kind of a bummer. But I'm going to try again after the Leviathan DLC. You know, after I'm done with that, I'm going to reinstall those and check it from time to time, see if it works before I install, you know, everything. So just in case you guys are wondering, and also it matters to anybody, I mean, the graphic's pretty awesome as it is, but it'll look even better. Unfortunately, yeah, I'm kind of catching up with my backlog, so I don't want to run behind. I'd love to have Leviathan 4K textures, but at the very least, if it does work, we'll have it for the, you know, continuation of the main quest line. Alex Garneau. Search possible locations across the galaxy to find him. Alright, well, we know where it is, it's just the log won't tell us. And I do have two systems, I believe, I have to go back to. I'm assuming I'm full of fuel, yeah. To recover resources there. Don't know what they are, of course. Could be anything, you know, from something important to just fuel or something. We're over here. Caleston Rift, scan for Dr. Garneau. Engage. We're in Baylor. Baylor. Well, Garneau is, I guess, in the Aysur system. But let's check out these planets. Let me just look at something. Is this a Reaper? This is not a Reaper. Well, infested system. It's a good way to put it. Cernunnos. Yeah, these names are familiar to me. Cernunnos is a sizable gas giant with high nitrogen content. It is believed to be an extrasolar capture due to its close stellar location. In a rare phenomenon, it is near enough to its red dwarf star to be within the life zone, although its massive size prevents the tidal lock that usually occurs at this range. While nothing could survive on the surface of a planet with such crashing gravity, Cernunnos' moon Caleston has life. Caleston Rift, yeah. Cernunnos was skimmed for its abundant hydrogen, and refineries on Caleston processed it into a metastable metallic form for use as starship fuel. The Reapers have since destroyed this operation. Oh, but it shows it as not a Reaper-occupied system. So is that incorrect, or did they... were they here and left? Caleston. Not in orbit? Oh, it's a satellite. Okay. Caleston is the largest satellite of the gas giant Cernunnos. Ancient asteroid strikes deposited major loads of element zero within the molten sulfur mantle. Eldfell Ashland Energy's mining operations made it the largest source of starship drive core material in the Attican Traverse, which threatened Caleston's native biodiversity with industrial waste. Caleston is racked with volcanism due to tidal stresses from Cernunnos. Because of weak solar output, plant-like life on Caleston is not carbon-based and photosynthetic, but silicon-based and thermosynthetic, requiring heat rather than sunlight to power chemical reactions. Interesting. First time I've ever heard this term, thermosynthetic, requires heat rather than sunlight. These organisms flourish in volcanic vents and during solar flares when Baylor, Caleston's... ooh, we got a typo here. Caleston's sun can double or triple in luminosity. Oxygen-breathing habitation is not possible outside its many domed cities. Those cities are now feasts for the Reapers, who drove off Caleston's protective fleet and now threaten to puncture domes to force the population into submission. I think it's an error on the map that they're not... it doesn't show occupied. Colony was founded in 1975 CE. The mid-70s, wow. Population 1.8 billion. All population estimates pre-invasion. Capitalist Sinu. Okay, so we got a little thing here. I can see this. Bress. A member of the Fomor Belt, Bress is a dwarf planet with no atmosphere. It is, however, rich in lithium, which is integral to the heat sinks of many starships and handheld weapons. A large robo-mining operation from Caleston once existed there, but the miners quickly abandoned the area when they learned they were in the path of the Reapers. Wise choice. Let's just fly around in this belt, see if there's anything else, which I'm not doing a good job of. Nope. Alatha. A tiny rock planet, Alatha is noted for its frigid temperatures and crushing nitrogen and krypton atmosphere. Lying out beyond the Fomor Belt, there is little to recommend it. And final planet. I don't know if there's anything to find in this system. It always shows nothing at all until you find something, so you clearly can't tell, right? Parthalon. A large planet composed of ice surrounding a rocky core, Parthalon retains trace gases of nitrogen and carbon monoxide. Its crushing gravity makes for an inhospitable stay and mining largely infeasible. However, its orbit's proximity to the mass relay in the system means space travelers will, for the next few years, use it for a gravitational slingshot to add speed on their way to and from Caleston. Yeah, we got some heavy freaking gravity going on there. I don't know. Might be able to hit all three planets from here.
Signal confirmed.
Oh my. Let's check out this first then. Fuel, which are already full, so... scan. Probe away. Cool. Synth diamond heat sinks. Nice. Pretty interesting. Hopefully we're 100%. Yes. Done. We can leave without the Reapers attacking. 50%, which means I'm assuming this is the only other system. Kind of far. I didn't take the most direct route, but we can easily make it back. So there's got to be two in here as well. Okay, Aysur. Agnon is the first planet. A hothouse planet, Agnon's scorching clouds of methane and sulfur dioxide give the planet a pale green color in visible light. The SO2 from volcanic activity rains down as sulfuric acid in the upper atmosphere, but this is boiled away before the liquid reaches the surface. Agnon's harsh environment has prevented exploration by anything except probes. Arvuna. Oh, this is a moon of that gas giant. Arvuna, a moon of Draenen, is classified as a water world because oceans of ice cover 90% of its surface. Besides prodigious sea life, Arvuna is home to a host of venomous arthropodal pests in the tropical zone with metallic carapaces similar to those found on Palavin to resist radiation coming from Draenen's magnetosphere. There are several well-shielded human colonies on Arvuna, although they are alienated from the Council and politically insignificant to the Traverse and Terminus systems. The Reapers have yet to reach Arvuna, concentrating instead on the Baylor system. While this cuts Arvuna off from the cluster's mass relay, it at least It is at least some evidence that the Reapers cannot be everywhere at once. That seems like a good thing to me. Kali founded in 2160 CE. Population is 948,700. Capital is Asa. Oh my god, surface temperature 1 Celsius. And this drain in here. A sizable hydrogen helium gas giant just on the far side of its pale yellow star's frost line, Draenen is known for its spectacular storms. At least 3 persistent observable spots, actually cyclonic and anti-cyclonic storms, have lasted for over 544 years, significantly longer than Jupiter's Great Red Spot. The largest of these spots, the Ishna, has consistently held a diameter over 3 times that of Earth. Alright, that's a lot of storms here. Draenen has 44 moons. 2 of them are of special interest to the Citadel Committee on Habitable Worlds. The first, Arvuna, is a life-bearing world that has already been colonized. The second, Alea, is slowly being terraformed into an ammonia-based world for Volus populations. Alright, so we don't have the other moon, then we only can see this one. Check the belt. Go around this way. Oh, see, that's why I do that. Mahavid?
We have located Garneau.
Ooh, we have located Garneau. Hear that? Mahavid is a metallic asteroid in the very sparse Nahara belt. It has a high nickel and iron content in the form of camosite. The rights to mine Mahavid belong to TGES Mineral Works, who sell their products primarily to the colonists of Arvuna. A close flyby reveals light emanating from its facilities. Population is 152, which of course is pre-invasion. Gonna go there last. See if there's anything else in this belt. And look at the other planets here. Nope. Okay, let's check out the other 3 and see if there's any goodies. Alformis. A hydrogen helium gas giant, Alformis had its Helium 3 refueling stations destroyed in an attack by Grow Zero, an anti-population terrorist group that wanted to stop further immigration to Arvuna. A consortium of Arvuna-based corporations are currently rebuilding the stations. Alliance Advisory. Alformis is not considered vital to the stability of the Aysur system. Civilians working on the Helium 3 platform should not expect Alliance military intervention in case of kidnapping or other violence. Well, that's a fine how-do-you-do, huh? Sheer. A remote rock planet, Captain Ice, Sheer has been exploited by Arvunan corporations for its minerals. Home to gold veins used in spaceship shielding as well as jewelry, and cobalt deposits used in high tensile alloys, Sheer's resources show no signs of being exhausted anytime soon. A light gravity helps keep the planetary exportation process cheap.
5th planet, which is where? Down here somewhere. Tamgauda.
The outermost planet of the Aysur system, Tamgauda is remote and largely unexplored. Its carbon dioxide atmosphere has long since frozen into fields of dry ice. Alright. Goodies? Oh, we missed this one. Shasu. Shasu is a dwarf planet that is believed to have been ejected from Agnin during a giant impact with another planet-sized body. At the time, a magma ocean covered much of Agnin's surface. The liquid rock sprayed into space where it coalesced and cooled over millions of years. It is theorized that during this cooling, Shasu orbited Agnin but was eventually pulled from that orbit by the gravity wells of other planets, primarily Draenen. Today, Shasu is relatively temperate with a light hydrogen-helium atmosphere that attracts spacers who use its atmosphere to refuel. Its crust composition is similar to Agnin, evident in its high sulfur content. Alright, we got a probe here. Nothing's coming for us, look at that. Well, we know there are resources here. That's right, they said the Reapers haven't been here. Maybe that's why it doesn't show a presence, because they've only been to one of the systems.
I found something.
Oh, goody. 150 units of fuel. Cool. Gotta check all these planets. Check this little one. No, and I checked in the middle of all this crap. Maybe check the asteroid, which is here. I found it myself without scanning. Huh? Okay. Alright, let's land. I could bring Javik. Abilities: Dark Channel, Lift Grenade, Pull, Slam, and Vengeful Ancient, which I guess is his class progression, his class ability. Weapons: none. I guess we got to give him that. Armor bonus is power damage plus 25%. Cool. Yeah, we'll keep them. I like both. We'll keep them like that, though. Yes, I am selecting him, and I'm going to bring Liara, of course. She will want to go wherever he goes, and I want to go wherever she goes. So there we go. She uses that stuff. Oh wait, that's Javik. Okay, never mind. Because it showed the Iris face, I was a little confused. So we need to give him like mods and stuff like that. So his assault rifle's the Avenger. Faceton. Matok's pretty good. I do like the Matok. Vindicator. Valkyrie. Chakram Launcher. Particle Rifle. Now I'm assuming things with high weight will affect his abilities as well, so that's why I'm just... For him, I'm gonna give him the Matok, because the Matok I like. Increases damage there. They're not really affected by rounds or capacity. At least as far as I know. This increases accuracy, I guess. Yeah. And he can also use a heavy pistol, which is only one of these two. Capacity. Damage is a little higher. Fire rate. Yeah, I'm guessing fire rate will work. Applies to a squad member's capacity. We'll give him the N7 Eagle. Introduce you to the Earth Alliance. One of the Earth Alliance standards, right? Pistol, piercing, magazine upgrade. Increased damage there, yes. Accuracy. Let's increase his accuracy. Done. Alright, so I've got two. I'm saving them. She's got two, which I'm saving. Javik here. Dark channel. Plague an opponent with a persistent, damaging biotic field. Effect transfers to a second target if the first is killed. Effect's length depends on dark channel's duration. Only one field may be active at a time. So it looks like a damage over time, a dot on this lift grenade. Lob this grenade into a group of enemies to send them flying, deal high damage. Pull and slam, we know. Vengeful Ancient, boost biotic and defensive abilities. Alright. Look at that, death. He is the Arm of Vengeance. Increased damage by 20. I'm gonna take a little of all these and then figure out what I want to expand even more. Grenade capacity. Oh, I don't have a rank in that. Never mind. Damage by 20%. So he has to relearn these spells? You figure, I guess, after all that time, 50,000 years or whatever. Increased duration by 40%. Slam. Vengeful Ancient. Health and shield by 10%. Power damage by 20%. Ditto again. Power damage by 40. Health and shield bonuses by 20. Alright, let me look at this dark channel and see what this does. Increase damage by 30% or duration. Damage. Slow target's movement speed by 30%. Or increase recharge speed. And ultimately, we have damage by 50. Increase damage or... Alright. What does this happen here? Damage. Impact radius. Two more grenades. Power duration by 50%. Slam floating targets to the ground as lift wears off, stunning them for 3 seconds. Impact radius. Duration by 50%. Impact radius by 2 meters, which is a very small amount. 40 damage per second to lifted targets. Increase all damage to targets lifted by pull by 25%. Launch 2 pulled projectiles to seek 2 targets. Or increase the recharge speed. Slam. Just want to see ultimately where this goes. Force by 40%. 2 meter radius increased. Damage and force of biotic detonation by 50%. Force by 50%. Just a detonate. Alright. Incapacitate a slam target for 5 seconds. Increase recharge speed by 50%. Right. And Vengeful Ancient. I looked at. Let's take more Dark Channel. I like that. Slow the speed. Let's max this out. Damage to armor and barriers. Or just overall damage. I'd say this is more obviously, but it's only for armor and barriers. I assume if they have like, I don't know. This just looks like more all purpose. Alright. Let's put pull up again. Damage per second to lifted targets. So one's a percentage and one's a... You know what? Since this is a percentage, this will scale with this. If I increase power damage, that will scale. So it won't be stuck at 40. It's going to increase with the percent. Of course, I don't know the numbers, or do we? Sorry, I was drinking a hot chocolate here. Very hot chocolate. Let's do this. And yeah, I'm pretty sure we can't take this, but we'll do this next. The percentage. Cool. Done.
We're about 5 minutes out, Commander.
What exactly is on this asteroid?
Mining facility. TGS Mineral Works. Small operation. Could be a good place for Leviathan to hide.
Can Leviathan hide there? How big is Leviathan? Nobody knows, right? Let's run through the brief.
We've all read Edie's notes on Bryson's lab. Any questions?
Do we have any more information on what Leviathan could be?
Not really. I only know it killed a Reaper.
But it is this Garneau human, Bryson's partner, we must locate.
Right.
We find Garneau, we find Leviathan.
Understood.
Reading Shepard's mind again. Well, it's got my attention.
Powerful enough to take down a Reaper, but hiding from the war. There's more to this.
Mm-hmm.
Just hope Garneau has the answers we need.
I'm reading Reaper enemy signatures in the asteroid field.
Oh.
Bryson said they were shadowing his field teams. They're after Leviathan too. Reapers are a good sign.
That's not something you hear every day.
Take us in.
Nope, you definitely don't hear that often. I saw that. We were able to just penetrate that effortlessly. I wonder what it guards against.
Don't go anywhere, Cortez. We'll grab this guy and be right out. Keep me updated on the Reaper situation.
Yes, Commander.
Alex Garneau is missing on Mahavid, which is under Reaper attack. Find Garneau and learn more about Leviathan. It stops asteroids. I guess it could tell, like, we have a heat signature or something like that, so it let us through. That's cool. I like that. Not only does it repel, but I guess that thing was going fast enough that it blew to bits. I'm just taking in the sights. Hold on. I think my run is off or something. Left shift. I was pressing that. Oh, I have to hold it. Hold on. Oh, that's walk, and that's... Okay, I just seem to be very slow. I don't know why. That'll fix it, though. Hello down there! Transit station. Look at those vents. You gotta deal with those vents. Run through them and stuff. No one's
scouting party. That sounds larger than the term scouting party would suggest.